holy William Shakespeare, Tim. It's a 1966 Batman script.
Great Scott, Paul. We'd better analyze it immediately.
My mic's at the ready.
I'm recording now.
To the bat poles.
Welcome to the Bat Poles. There we take a deep look at the Fledermaus Mensch. This is Tim in Tokyo.
I'm off to Autobahn.
With my brother Paul in Hanover, New Hampshire.
Jawohl. Herr Kommandant. I know nothing. I see nothing.
Our theme version this time was performed by William Cheung at the YouTube channel W. Cheung Music with no spaces. That's Cheung with C-H-E-U-N-G. Uploaded to YouTube February 3rd, 2017. Recorded at Music to You Studios, Kings Norton, Birmingham. So apparently he's British, or lives in Britain anyway.
Yeah, I thought his piano had a kind of Cockney accent.
So I thought, he does a fine job on the Batman theme, but it's not the best tune to really show off your piano skills on. So
I listened to a
couple of the other video. Well, so there's one where he's playing Toto's Africa, which is pretty good. It says it's a rehearsal, and there's a chorus singing it, but you can't see them. The camera is just kind of looking up at him. Mm-hmm. And the sound is not very good, but he plays it well. And then there's also, I watched part of Mozart Piano Concerto where he's playing with a, like, maybe 15-piece orchestra.
Oh, gosh. So he is quite serious. Yes, this seems more a lark by comparison.
Yes. Just for fan service.
Yes, fan servicing.
Bat fan service. Okay, so if you haven't listened to our previous episode on Peter Rabe's Two-Face script, do an emergency bat turn back to that episode before listening to this one. Yes. This episode is about Lorenzo Semple Jr.'s adaptation of that. Adaptation? What's the right word?
Adaptation, probably.
Okay. Of that Two-Face script into the arc that was broadcast, The Joker's Last Laugh and The Joker's Epitaph.
However, this is a first draft. Yes, yeah. It is not the final version.
Dated January 3rd, 1967. The episodes aired February 15th and 16th. So that gives you an idea of the turnaround time. Like 6 weeks.
Holy emergency bat turn, speaking of which.
And we do see some remnants of the Two-Face script that are in Semple's version, but were cut from the final version, and we'll get to those. I noticed that this script has no handwritten comments on it at all. That surprised me a bit, because most of them seem to have notes. Apparently, I mean, who knows exactly where these scripts came from, but this one must not have passed through the hands of Hoffman or Horowitz.
Right. My first impression was that it might have been an assistant to Horowitz or, who owned this particular script. Because, among other things, the moment at which Bruce Wayne reveals that he's Batman at the end of the first episode of the arc seems like something that would have magnetized commentary from somebody.
Yeah, I mean, that's the kind of thing that gets struck from a script, 100% of the time.
That's right.
Even if it's written by Lorenzo Semple Jr., it's coming out.
So, yeah, that was the absence of any hen scratchings there was pretty shocking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I'm sure Horowitz's version had big scribbles there, like, no! Some of my observations are just from coming back to this, you know, a few years after we did our original episode about this arc. Mm-hmm. But I was noticing how this script, as written by Semple, seems to be about Batman and Robin repeatedly trying to entrap Joker, goading him into breaking the law when they are there to see it so they can arrest him.
Right, right. And, you know, constantly complaining about the ways in which, you know, things that he's done based on intent, right, based on Joker's intent, could be construed as non-harmful. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, maybe they just wanted to make Commissioner Gordon laugh.
Yeah, well, that's
maybe they just wanted to make him happy.
That's cut, but yeah, it's we'll get to that one too. That's mm-hmm. I wrote "huh" next to that one. But yeah, you know, in part one, Bruce and Robin try to trick Joker into printing counterfeit money in front of them so that they can arrest him, and then in the bank at the end of part two, you know, Robin says that they had nothing on Joker until he ordered the robots to kill them.
Right.
Although what's odd is that just because Joker is no longer counterfeiting after the printing press scene, the duo just dropped that idea completely. Even though they caught him red-handed, now it doesn't matter anymore for some reason.
Yeah. Well, the Bass-Pow fight just, you know, kind of changes the entire, you know, tenor of the adventure, I guess.
One other thing that I like about the script is how, and I don't know that this happened in other Joker scripts to this extent anyway, but Joker keeps working in words like comical and whimsical where they wouldn't normally belong.
Oh, robots! Give him a whimsical whammy! Quick, we're humorous robots! Exert yourselves! Conclude this comical charade!
Very well, then. We must be content with our humorous alternate plan B.
Right, right. As if there was some kind of contractual obligation to Joker Corp to include, you know, those particular adjectives.
Branding.
Yeah, exactly. But I also noticed that the word filthy comes up a fair number of times, and that adjective seems a little bit out of character for Joker, perhaps. But it seems a little mincy. Like, you know, it's a little queer for him to say, oh, God, those filthy, that during my last turn at that filthy penitentiary, you know, I built these robots as part of my, you know, rehabilitation, you know, project, whatever. Mm.
And creature comes up a lot, too. So the robots keep getting called creatures.
Yeah, just interesting rhetorical choices there.
One other thing I wanted to mention before we get into going through the script is, did you notice repeatedly in the script, he's referred to as the Joker, but as shot, the is usually cut. He's just Joker. Mm. And I wonder what the motivation for that was.
Interesting. Well, perhaps it was just to make it sound less abnormal whenever someone called him Joker. Instead of saying, what do we do now with the Joker?
Yeah.
As if that were to be expected.
The masked meanie in that comics book that you had many, many years ago
from
the library.
A Wonder Warthog comic book. Oh, no. please don't hurt me, the masked meanie.
So, yeah, I guess what that comic was making fun of was that sometimes the villain has the, but when you address the villain, he doesn't have the. But he doesn't have to have the at all.
Mm-hmm.
So right. I guess it's just, it's just easier if we completely get rid of the article.
I'm sure that's got something to do with it. It's probably about simplification.
Mm-hmm. Now, it would be interesting to compare that to the comics of the time. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I mean, to what extent was he the Joker versus being Joker?
Yeah, this could be completely incorrect factually, but my instinct tells me that in the early 70s, when Joker was brought back as a homicidal maniac, after mm-hmm. having been goofy, you know, throughout the 50s and 60s, largely anyway. When Neil Adams and Danny O'Neill brought him back in Batman 251, I get the impression that he might have been called the Joker more frequently, just as Batman was referred to as the Batman in the Irv Novik, Danny O'Neill Batman stories of the late 60s and early 70s. But that's, again, just a speculation.
By the way, I should mention here, the way that I've set this up this time, comments from listeners about the script, we're going to get to that in the Bat Inbox.
Okay.
Well, I've written up some notes about this with page references, and if you have some certain ones, too, just throw them in.
I do, so please go right ahead.
So, page 2. Now, I was shocked to find that, you know, in the Rabe script, you had that whole car chase scene at the beginning with a mm-hmm. rich person unwittingly handing out counterfeit money. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the characters are changed in Semple's version. And as broadcast, it's a much simpler scene. But as written, the car chase is still there.
Not only that, but apparently the civilians get perhaps like outright murdered by police shooting at the car as Miranda tries to escape.
Yeah, I mean, the cop is shooting at someone for passing counterfeit money.
Right, and I should correct myself. She's not trying to escape. She's just driving away. She had no idea that she had passed counterfeit money to the typed bum. How does Semple refer to him? A classic tattered bum comes up beside her and takes off his hat, beginning a whining spiel. She just drives away after passing him the half-fake counterfeit 100. And then she gets shot at, and then Commissioner Gordon then, in the following scene, has to remark that, or you know, that you know, the victims of stray bullets will be compensated.
Yeah, the victims will be provided for, as usual, by the Stray Bullet Indemnification Fund. So apparently this is an everyday occurrence for the GCPD to shoot bystanders.
Well, even though this bit didn't make it to the final script, I think it just goes to show how, you know, clearly Semple understood the GCPD's incompetence as mm-hmm. a running joke.
Now, what was really interesting about this to me is that the officer in question is identified as Officer Hoffman, as in Charles Hoffman. And now I'm probably way overthinking this, but if you put that together with Robin a few pages later, and this makes it into the final, Robin referring to the bat detector setting to super laugh track sensitivity, I wonder if Semple was, like, commenting on the direction the show had taken in the second season.
I don't actually think that's completely out of line. It might be a little pushy, but the laugh track sensitivity, I mean, the reference to the laugh track and to the comedy aspects of the show, which were becoming, you know, as we have, you know, talked about a little bit out of hand. It makes a lot of sense to me. At the very least, it's you know, some kind of a rib at the lack of a laugh track on the show and the uncertainty that early viewers had about whether this was supposed to be funny or not. You know, the test audiences who infamously weren't sure whether to laugh or not laugh when the pilot was first broadcast, or not broadcast but shown to the test audiences.
Yeah. But I mean, the reference to laugh track there is always kind of stuck out to me. I mean, it doesn't seem like a natural choice of words. And, you know, this being a TV show that was more or less a comedy, it does feel like it's some kind of a comment. But then, like,
absolutely
kind of calling out the name of the current script editor at the same time, which, of course, doesn't make it to the final.
Right, and thinking of an editor as a you know, an incompetent policeman, someone who edits or, you know, edits badly or edits too draconianly or just, you know, too ham.
And is outwitted by Stanley Ralph Ross.
Right, right. Ham-handedly. Yeah, the joke is just, it's too rich, too delicious, delicious.
By the way, the bum breaks out a newspaper as shot, and but we what you can't tell from the way it's shot is that, as Semple writes, it's supposed to be the daily racing form.
Mm-hmm. So like, you know, he's ready to bet the phony 100 immediately.
Yeah, until he realizes that it's phony.
Mm-hmm. Now, as shot, that scene ends with him yelling, you know, pretty much, "Help, police!"
Yeah, just as it's scripted, "Help, police, fuzz."
Mm-hmm. But only in this draft of the script does it go on to include major malfeasance by a trigger-happy policeman.
Right.
Just imagining the headlines, you know, cop maims 12, you know, 11 less than last time.
So pages 4 and 5 at Wayne Manor. So it's basically the same conversation between Bruce and Dick that we get as shot. Mm-hmm. But when Alfred comes to alert them to a bat phone call, he takes a strange detour into talking about Gresham's Law.
Alfred, begging your pardon, sir. Bruce. Yes, Alfred. Alfred. The telephone in the study, sir, concerning a famous principle of economics. Bruce and Dick jump up. Dick. What? Economics? Alfred. Indeed, Master Dick. It is known as Gresham's Law. It states that bad money tends to drive good money out of circulation. Bruce. Come on, old chum. Time for a practical lesson. So long, Aunt Harriet. As dynamic duo race out, camera remains on Alfred and Aunt Harriet. She makes a face. Aunt Harriet, goodness, Gresham's Law. Who'd ever want to pass a law like that?
That was a key component of the Two-Face script, but it's completely unnecessary here. It's like, mm-hmm. Semple felt like he needed to shoehorn it in somehow. Right. But why?
Maybe just for the sake of Aunt Harriet's gag line, goodness, Graham's Law, who'd ever want to pass a law like that? The confusion of a scientific or, you know, predictive law with, with a justice system law.
Mm-hmm.
He's the grand old man of Marvel. Stan Lee was involved in the creation of some of the world's favorite comics characters, like Spider-Man, Iron Man, Thor, and the Hulk. But he didn't create them on his own. Artists like Jack Kirby and Steve Ditko were also instrumental in the creation of these characters, but many fans of the Marvel movies don't even know their names. Did Stan take too much credit by design? Or was he just given the credit because he's more media-friendly? Millions of words have been written about Lee, both to praise him and disparage him. What are the books about Lee that you should read? On Deconstructing Comics, we're going to screen the books about Lee so you don't have to. Join us, True Believer, as we read as many books about Stan Lee as we can stand, and compare them to each other. Find Deconstructing Comics in your favorite podcast app. Excelsior.
Hello, I'm Ken Holzhauser, and if you're looking for something new in comic books, may I recommend my newest comic, The Quick and the Dad, a love letter to the DC, Marvel, Archie, and Harvey comics of my youth. This comic has everything. It has spaceships, dad jokes, alien invasions, time travel, supervillains, and so many bad puns. Hopefully you'll like it. It's the cutest comic you've never heard of, and it's available today in print and digital from IndiePlanet.com. That's The Quick and the Dad. Join that other dynamic duo, won't you?
After the ad break, I noticed, this has nothing to do with the script, but in the usual bat stock of Batman and Robin coming down the bat poles and running to the Batmobile, so, you know, they always kind of do the pieces of bat stock a little bit differently. So it's not exactly the same sequence every time.
Right, and that's, you know, one thing that I noticed very early on in this podcast series that I was really impressed by.
Hmm. But, you know, sometimes we see them fastening their seatbelts. Mm-hmm. And we don't see that in this one, but I noticed during the far shot of the Batmobile in the Batcave, on the soundtrack, there's a really quick seatbelt click. Like it's almost kind of subliminal. Like, fasten your seatbelts, kids.
Interesting.
It just was interesting to me that even though they weren't showing the belts, they had to get that in there somehow.
Mm-hmm.
Page 8. I was interested by the insertion in the final version, not in the script, of Batman referencing the cufflink and the cable down Gordon's trouser leg as Exhibit A and Exhibit B.
Yes.
Ingenious. This criminal mirth issues from a tiny super-powered loudspeaker built into your left cufflink.
Great Scott!
Exhibit A. The agile crook also managed to slip an induction receiving antenna into your left trouser leg. Exhibit B.
So, Batman's more of a cop than the cops.
Right. Yeah, and, you know, Batman's concentration on or focus on how, you know, knowledge is their most important tool as crime fighters reminds me of the way in which the show generally, you know, depicts Batman as a detective, Batman and Robin as a detective team. I also am reminded here of the great comment by the guys who do the To the Bat Bulls blog that is not related to this podcast when they're, you know, talking about that scene and imagining, you know, just exactly how Commissioner Gordon could have not noticed that there was somebody in his trousers, dropping the antenna down. It's like, what do they say? It's something like, yes, I remember now, some oddly costumed fellow did get into my pants this morning. Why, yes, there was a stranger in my pants on the subway. How could I have forgotten?
As shot, they seem to have, like, you know, added to the joke by having that cable wrapped around his waist, which is not written in the first draft here.
Right. Yes, apparently this stranger was not just, you know, didn't just quote unquote bump into him, but actually like wrapped him, circled him like a maypole 5 or 6 times.
One of the things I like about going through the script sometimes is that I catch lines that I never noticed before.
Even if they're in the final shot
version? Right, yeah, they're in the final show, but maybe they're a little garbled or something, or you're just, something else is distracting me during that scene and I'm not paying attention to the line. Mm-hmm. So one of those is on page 12 when Joker says to the robots, "Exterminate them utterly to primordial bat stuff."
Yes, that line widened my eyes a little bit too. I don't remember hearing it in the show.
Yeah. Another one of those on page 16, as Mr. Glee crashes to the floor, it makes part of Robin's line inaudible, where he says, "Holy clockworks."
A mechanical marvel!
And that's definitely what he's saying. I know now from looking at the script and matching it up with the episode, but I could never quite catch it before.
Another fun thing about reading scripts is, references in the stage direction, which of course never make it into the final script because nobody reads it out loud unless you're like Ted Knight in the Mary Tyler Moore Show, reading the stage directions out loud. But on page 12, when the robots go after the table, when Joker tells them to, you know, go smash the table to primordial bat stuff, robots Boff and Yawk trundle over to it mechanically, suddenly start flailing with fists. What power? A couple of blows and they've smashed table like it was made of balsa wood. Well, in fact, it probably was.
Yes.
So Semple's jokes, you know, based on the actual props themselves, and breakaway things. Candy glass gets referred to in some Semple scripts as well, and sugar spun smoke at one point in this very script.
Yeah, well, let's see. Well, we'll get to that. I can't find it right off.
Right, but those references always crack me up. References to the fakery that they're performing by, you know, making heavy-looking tables out of balsa wood.
So, in the bank, for some reason, Mr. Glee is wearing a Homburg hat.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed like maybe Semple wanted it to pop up in the air when Batman twisted his nose and revealed that he was a robot.
Right, right, just to make it look a little more spectacular.
Mm-hmm.
Or perhaps to make the Mr. Glee look slightly more like Winston Churchill.
When we talked about the Two-Face script, I mentioned, you know, the addition of, in the Semple version, of Batman kind of scolding Mr. Flam for not screening his employees carefully enough.
Right.
As, like, wanting everyone else to be civically responsible like him. But I don't think I quite touched on the idea that also Batman is Bruce Wayne. So he's acting on behalf of his other identity there, you know, talking to basically one of his employees, right? Or certainly someone that he has some authority over, even though he isn't there as Bruce Wayne. He says he speaks for Bruce Wayne, or he's sure that he speaks for Bruce Wayne.
Yeah, I'm sure I speak for your chairman, Bruce Wayne, when I say you owe that to your depositors.
I'm very, very sure that I speak for Bruce Wayne.
On behalf of Bruce Wayne, am very disappointed in you.
I'm just noticing here on page 11, another use of the word creature, but changed. So Joker calls Josie foolish, trepidatious creature, but creature is changed to child as shot. Okay, what else?
Let's see. If we're up to page 17 already, since we just talked about Batman's admonition to Mr. Flam, the business of the robots crying gets cut. Robots crying at the demise of Mr. Glee.
Yeah, well, that seemed really dark to me, that the robots are crying about that. And it felt to me like it was kind of an echo of Two-Face's crying of murder most foul in the Rabe script. Now, Joker doesn't seem to care that the robots are crying, but
right, he just makes them laugh. He reprograms them effectively.
Yeah.
They're grieving, Joker. Can't you do something, says Josie? Yeah, that seems like a real downer.
Just before that, I wanted to note that, so the conversation after Mr. Glee is revealed to be a robot is cut quite a bit. But also, the applause by the bank patrons as the duo is leaving, that's not in the script.
Now, Tim, you've watched the actual arc more recently than I have. I watched it a couple of weeks ago. Does Batman still say at the top of page 17, does he still say, all part of the crime fighter's arsenal, Mr. Flam, knowledge is our primary tool?
No.
That's the line I was referring to before.
That's cut as shot.
Okay. But it still gives us some evidence of Semple's, you know, considering Batman and Robin primarily as detectives.
Up to page 19, as Joker and Josie are leaving to track Batman to the Batcave, they get out a Tommy gun and grenades. They mean business. But you don't see them grabbing anything as shot. And so later, when they're about to find the mini Batcave, the dialogue is kind of softened, where, you know, it's originally like Joker talking about like killing Batman and Robin explicitly when they come out of the Batcave.
You get the feeling that Semple had just like finished watching some like late 60s gangster movies like Dillinger or something before he, you know, sat down to revise this script.
Well, I mean, it's interesting to think that Semple seems to have, now it's kind of cut out of this one, but Semple maybe wrote some of the shows that the episodes that had the most gunplay in them. Certainly, you know, the Penguin Goes Straight this probably has more shooting than any other Batman arc.
Oh, excuse me. The John Milius version of Dillinger wasn't filmed until 1973, so...
okay.
Sorry, yeah, couldn't have seen that one.
Well, Semple got in his time machine and traveled ahead to 73.
Well, Joker had a time machine once, so, you know, maybe Semple had one in his back pocket as well.
Back before that, when Joker and Josie come out of their hideout, the script says several bystanders gawk at the Joker-mobile, but as shot, it's about 24 people. Is that several? And they also applaud. So the director, I don't remember who the director was right off, seemed to have something for crowds applauding for both Batman and the Joker.
Mm-hmm. Does seem that way.
Director is Oscar Rudolph.
Good old Oscar Rudolph.
As they're following Batman and Robin, a bit that's cut from the chase scene, Batman and Robin avoid a hospital quiet zone. So there's more civic responsibility.
Woo!
And I thought this was a interesting line, also cut from the chase scene, with Batman saying, if they were capable of learning, they wouldn't be criminals. So criminals are stupid.
Right. Or just, maybe not. Let's just say they're handicapped in a particular way, or they're differently abled when it comes to their ability to produce new knowledge.
Okay.
Change their behavior based on consequences.
And I've noted before that Semple seemed to love to use the word tricky. You know, tricky mm-hmm, this mm-hmm. and tricky that. But some of them get changed as shot. On page 21, there's a reference to a tricky bat deflector, which is changed to trusty bat deflector.
Is that Robin's line?
I believe so.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
44, or shot 43, page 21.
So, yeah, the chase scene is somewhat longer, and there's more of Josie giving Joker driving directions. And on page 22, she originally said, quick, hard left, and as shot, that's changed to simply faster, which seems to me like a little bit too much of a command to be giving to the Joker.
Mm-hmm.
That sounds like Joker would be saying that to someone else who was driving, you know, to a flunky mm-hmm. who was driving, but not the other way around.
Well, malls have a little more leeway, I think.
Yeah, I guess so.
Because they're, you know, supposedly the love interest.
Mm-hmm. And I don't remember if I mentioned this on our episode of Joker's Last Laugh, but as they come to that field where the mini Batcave is, they say that they're turning right, but they're actually turning left. They're turning to our right, but...
Clearly a deep political commentary on conservatism and liberalism.
Ah, sure, okay.
Which we simply don't have time to go into any further here.
Another one from the category of lines I couldn't catch until I saw the script. On page 23... Just after Joker and Josie get out of the car as they're looking for the Batcave, Joker says, oh, frabjous day. I had to look up frabjous.
Is it actually a word?
It's a Lewis Carroll word. It's a Lewis Carroll coinage from Through the Looking Glass. Google's dictionary speculates that it's a combination of fair and joyous.
Hmm.
Okay, frabjous. That's a pretty deep cut to stick into a script like this.
Fun, though. 'Twas brillig in the slithy toves.
Yeah, on 24 is where they're talking about, actually, yeah, Joker says, we'll gas them from the cave, then mow them down as they emerge. But it's changed to then get them when they come out.
It's a little less Bonnie, you know, conclusion of Bonnie and Clyde.
mow them down.
I love the miniature Batcave. Love the miniature Batcave. I love that bit so very much. If you know, I don't remember ever seeing that as a kid, but if I had, or you know, if I'd remembered it, I'm sure that I would have used it as some kind of Kickstarter to like building our own exterior of the Batcave out of cardboard. But just the miniaturization, I would have glommed onto it as a kind of action figure feature, something you can, you know, produce for action figures. Just, I don't know, just miniature stuff like that always made me very happy as a kid.
Mm-hmm. And as shot, they improve on that scene a bit. Semple apparently is thinking that the Batcave sign, which of course Batman would never have outside the real Batcave, is like not attached to the cave, but like separate, like the Gotham City 14 miles sign. Mm-hmm. And then he has, I think it's Josie, pick it up and flip it over to see the message. What is it? Laugh, criminals laugh.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But the way that they actually did it, where, you know, Joker picks up the mini bat cave and it says laugh, criminals laugh underneath it, is much better for the camera. You can get it, see a much big, it's much bigger than that little sign that Semple had in mind.
Right, and it's also more of a joke on the smallness of it and how Joker, you know, simply seeing it on the scanner or, you know, seeing the image of it, could not tell the scale because there was nothing to compare it to until they actually are like standing in front of it when they drive up to it. Which strikes me as a little bit of a self-conscious or, you know, reflexive joke about how miniatures are used in special effects. I'm reminded of the film Danger Diabolique, in which most of the gigantic array of cars that Diabolique has in his underground cave are basically like miniatures and cutouts from magazine photos. And yet, it's shot in such a way because the scale is, you know, manipulated that you can't possibly tell that these are just like, you know, magazine cutouts. They look like full sized vehicles when pasted together in the shot.
So on page 28, what we were talking about a bit ago, the line that I wrote, huh, next to. So, after Batman says, "More than possible, Robin, too bad we have no proof that the Joker is W.C. Whiteface." Mm-hmm. And then what's cut after that, Robin says, "What do you mean, no proof? That tiny laugh receiver he slipped up Commissioner Gordon's sleeve." Batman: "It could have been an act of kindness, an innocent attempt to lighten the commissioner's burdens with heartwarming mirth."
But I'm... it grabs me a bit that they're concerned about intent. You know, they're thinking about intention. You know, whether the Joker, the Joker could simply say, "Well, we wanted to brighten Commissioner Gordon's day, so we stuffed the antenna down his pants and the speaker into his belt or pocket or whatever."
Cufflink.
Cufflink. Yes. So, they're thinking really carefully about how intent could be used to undermine an argument that this was, you know, done to terrorize or, you know, torture Commissioner Gordon. And that, that shows at least a little bit of a sensitivity to how the justice system actually works.
Hmm. On 29, so before the whole bit with Bruce Wayne arriving at the comics printing shop, there's a half a page of Robin and Bruce setting up for that. And I think it was really smart to cut that because you've got a little bit too much information there. It's nice to be a little bit less certain of what's going on.
Have the truth unfold as the action plays out.
Yeah, so I don't know if that was Rudolph's decision or Hoffman or what, but yeah, it was good to get rid of it.
And also, the fact that there's a bat climb leads to the possibility that there might be a cameo, and Semple's script alludes to that. You know, a cameo could happen here if desired. But it would seem a little strange not to have Batman involved in a Clime cameo like that.
Right, yeah, every Clime cameo had both Batman and Robin in the scene, and here you've got Robin climbing solo, and then Alfred climbing solo. And you don't even see Robin's climb at all.
Right, there wouldn't be anybody for him to talk to unless there was a cameo, but the cameo wouldn't be appropriate without both Batman and Robin, it seems. At least it wouldn't be conventional enough in terms of what the show has been doing up to this point.
On 32, there's a funny line that was cut. Bruce is talking about offering Joker the being vice chairman of the board of the Gotham National Bank. And he says, how you might profit from that, I'll leave to your imagination.
Wait a minute, isn't there a version of that line in the final version?
I don't think so. I mean, there is quite a bit of change on this page.
Mm-hmm.
And I notice a lot of the change on this page is fixing a problem that Semple left in the script.
Hmm.
As written in this draft, Bruce never signs the paper giving, you know, putting Joker on the board, and yet it becomes legally binding anyway.
Yes.
So it's changed here so that Bruce is saying that it is a personally signed document.
Mm-hmm.
So Joker can run off with it. It's already got the signature on it, and so he is on the bank board.
Right, it's just here Bruce says, you know, I'll give you the form once you've run off some counterfeit bills for me so I can check their, you know, how authentic they look.
Yeah, because when I read it through the first time before I rewatched the episode, I had written in here, Bruce never signed it, right? Yeah, and then on 33, as you mentioned, Robin breaks the glass of the window. And it says, Robin leaps through in a cloud of flying spun sugar. But as shot, the window is just open when he gets there. Must be a warm day.
Yes, or they're, you know, trying to save the show from Burt Ward's lawyer. Just tired of Burt Ward getting scratched and blown up, if we're to believe Return to the Batcave's account of things.
I was reading it, and I noticed that Bruce had, good Lord, I circled that, because I knew that wasn't going to make it. You know, it's a little bit too religion-ish, and of course it is Great Scott as shot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, even What the Devil is a little too close for comfort.
So on 35, as Joker has strapped Robin to the press, Bruce tries to throw Joker off by admitting he's Batman. And we mentioned already, you know, that kind of thing always gets cut.
Mm-hmm. What a lousy idea.
And so then in part two, on page 38, Bruce is calling Robin old chum. And that only kind of works when Bruce has admitted to being Batman. But, you know, Bruce should not be calling Robin old chum.
Yes.
So,
yes.
As shot, he's calling him Boy Wonder. And yes, Batman never addresses him as Boy Wonder, but Bruce does. So, there's a nice point of consistency in this show.
That's right.
We should do an episode about what must have been in the Bat Bible. Because, you know, there are certain points like that they're very consistent on, I think, all the way through the series.
Right, that along with, you know, Batman and Robin never showing up with their cowls or masks off and the rest of their costumes on.
Yeah, they're either completely in costume or completely out of costume.
Right, the Ten Commandments of Batman 66.
Page 38, as Alfred is waiting on the street, but he's wearing an opera-type cape and not wearing the bat cowl. And then he reveals to the audience that he's wearing the Batman costume, and he gets out the cowl and puts it on. Now, we know that the cowl didn't go on easy. So
right, and the cape went on over it.
Yeah, I mean, it just wouldn't be possible to do it on camera in an easy way. So
right.
It's not surprising that it starts out with him fully in costume.
Mm-hmm.
Page 40, after Alfred has come in the window as Batman and the crooks have left, Semple suggests that running the film backwards would clear out the smoke quickly. But now, as shot, it's clearly not reversed. But I've always noticed in that scene, the smoke does clear up surprisingly quickly, and I wonder what the, was they... They must have had some fans employed besides the little tiny one.
Yeah, no, there must have been a big fan or two just off camera. Yeah, I noticed that as well.
Very quiet fans, I think. Can't hear anything.
Well, of course, you know, you can always, you know, overdub the dialogue and just, you know, cut the soundtrack out.
Hmm. You have to go back and see if there are any dubbed-in lines. I think there might be one or two.
Mm-hmm.
Quickly, Alfred. The Bat-Fan.
Very good, sir.
Well done, Alfred. And bravely, too.
So after the printing press scene, there's a big swath of pages cut.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a newsboy shouting out that Joker is now officer of the bank. Now, there is another newsboy later in part two that does make it to the screen. But Semple was relying a little bit too much on the newsboy bit. I wonder if it was
extra
the same newsboy.
Expository, read all about it.
Then there's a scene with Gordon questioning Bruce about putting Joker in that position. So that's like more setup for Bruce getting put in the straitjacket later on.
Right.
Then when Bruce is gone, Gordon picks up the bat phone and tells Rob, of course, Batman's not there. He's out on crime patrol or something, supposedly.
Mm-hmm.
And Gordon tells Robin to tell Batman to get Bruce Wayne because he's in league with the Joker.
Saints alive, Chief O'Hara says on 44. I never thought I'd see the day when Bruce Wayne was in league with that crooked Joker. Yes, it's black, all right, says Commissioner Gordon.
And Gordon advises, calls up Bonnie and tells her to withdraw the entire funds of the Police Benevolent Fund, also your own life savings, if any.
Ah, yes, Commissioner Gordon, helping out people within the GCPD, but not announcing it to the greater public, so there won't be a bank run.
Yeah, holy bank run.
Holy cop corruption.
Then a whole bit with Joker and his robots arriving at the bank, and Joker zapping Mr. Flam with a hand buzzer.
Mm-hmm.
And then Batman and Robin arriving outside the bank and discussing the Joke-mobile. Robin, holy junk pile, what's that jalopy? Batman, looks like a nasty Joke-mobile to me. Robin,
nasty.
The crook, he must be already at work. Batman, I'm afraid you're right. Let's go in and check. And then that's where the broadcast episode picks up with Batman and Robin coming into the bank.
And noticing that the criminal robots are installed as tellers.
But then there's 48. Another bit cut, the last half of page 48, where Joker tries to use the hand buzzer on Batman, but he gets zapped, and Batman says that they have polarity reversers in the palms of our bat gauntlets.
Yeah, one wonders if those scenes got cut because Semple is calling for a special effect there. Zapping sound again as electric halo dances around Joker's head and the crook leaps into the air. Now, of course, if they shot it that way, if they shot it with the hand buzzers, they could have just, you know, had a big sound effect and made the person, like, you know, the actor jump around and ignored the electric halo effect altogether. So that probably isn't the reason why it was cut. It just does seem, you know, inconsequential to the plot.
Yeah,
that's probably the reason why these bits don't happen.
Yeah, it occurs to me that there is another Semple script where a halo is put around somebody when they get zapped. Can you think which arc it is?
Do 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 do. I can't.
Penguin's Nest.
Yes.
When Penguin's in jail. And the guard is zapped.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's our favorite cop who shows up like a dozen times.
Oh, yeah.
We haven't talked about him in so long.
It's true.
I'm talking, of course, about James O'Hara.
You've got me wondering whether Semple has somehow, you know, got what he, you know, got the Christmas present he'd always wanted when making Flash Gordon, because, you know, Ming the Merciless has got, you know, big electrical zaps he's able to to fling around. And I think he zaps Flash Gordon at one point and has a big, who has a big electrical halo around him for a while. So, you know, maybe he finally, you know, got all the zapping he wanted when he made Flash Gordon.
On page 50, Batman calls Josie that sleazy mall, which is not really on brand. It's changed to deluded mall, which is much better. For
Very Batman. Much on brand.
Mm. Yes.
Poor deluded girl.
51, Joker and Josie leave to talk to Bruce, and Batman and Robin go for a quote-unquote safety inspection. Then Batman is hot-dogging. He zooms past the Jokemobile like it's standing still, I think Semple says. Which, I don't know if that's out of character or if it's impish humor Batman.
It might be a little bit of the impish humor. There's impish humor going on when Batman talks about his, you know, rather delightedly about reprogramming the robots. Even though what the robots are doing is not exactly delightful. They're, you know, threatening to shoot bank customers between the eyes.
Well, and the mini Batcave is kind of impish humor Batman, too, except we don't get to see him say anything about it. He does in this draft, but it's cut. So, let's see. At Wayne Manor, when Joker and Josie are trying to blackmail Bruce...
Imagine my ghastly situation, Mr. Wayne. Legally installed in the bank, but watched like an insect by that infernal Cape Crusader. If I misappropriate a dime, the bat will pounce.
Yes, I can understand for someone of your dubious character that might prove annoying.
Then cut lines. Joker, annoying, I'm half demented with whimsical outrage. Josie, sweetie, your blood pressure...
I'm half demented with whimsical outrage. I'm gonna jot that down, write it on my hand, and use it the next time my students, you know, exasperate me. Which doesn't happen, but still, it would be hilarious to say that out loud.
But the sweetie, your blood pressure makes them sound like an old married couple. Which doesn't really work when Josie is about to throw herself at Bruce.
Right. Yeah, good point.
I noted that Bruce and Dick looking at each other and saying Plan B is not in the script.
Plan B?
Somebody added that later. Now, on 56, Aunt Harriet happens in after this talk of Josie marrying Bruce comes up, and she's overjoyed that Bruce is finally going to get married.
Finally, your heterosexuality will become a matter of public record.
And now, this line especially catches my eye. Bruce will still have plenty of time for your silly old fishing, I'm sure, she says to Dick. That almost sounds like Return of the Cape Crusaders. Because I don't think on the show Aunt Harriet ever, like, made that kind of comment about them going fishing, like bringing it up when they hadn't first brought it up.
Right.
Now, of course, it's not the winking as in Return of the Cape Crusaders, where she's like, I know your secret. You're not fishing. I've been reading Wortham.
Yeah, that's right. Or I've been reading Frank Gorshin's newspaper about Wortham.
Yeah. Now, I was interested too. So, that's cut, but also in the tag scene, is originally supposed to take place at Wayne Manor, and Aunt Harriet is involved in that, too. And it makes me wonder if, like, now we know that this is getting to be late in season two, and Madge Blake was not in the best of health. And I'm wondering if those bits are cut for that reason.
Yeah, it's a good question. 57, we're back to the newsboy. Read all about it. Millionaire Bruce Wayne to wed. Expository.
Yeah, that's the one that makes it in. 58, Robin says Joker's blackmail threat isn't worth an old Nixon button. I'm sure that's supposed to be Nixon. not Cincinnati Bengals player Joe Mixon, who wasn't born yet at the time.
Nice.
But of course, that's changed to a tinker's darn. Yeah, now, of course, Nixon at this point, he had lost to Kennedy and was, I don't know what he was doing in 1967.
Well, getting ready to be elected president. I'm sure he was campaigning.
Possibly, although I don't know if campaigns started that early in those days.
Well, you know, I think the primaries were still at the same time, but again, I have no real idea. But we are, you know, re-entering the era of Nixon. I suspect, though, that the reason that the epithet was changed was simply to keep it timeless rather than, you know, this is, they're thinking about the future of syndication here.
Yeah.
So keeping references like that out, or keeping them obscure, like having LBJ be president but not mentioning his name, or, you know, kind of the order of the day.
Getting rid of the old Nixon button turned out to be a really wise choice because, you know, in reruns in like 1969 or 70, it would have sounded odd.
Yeah, for sure.
Nixon was, in fact, president.
Right, right. You wouldn't want to be referring to him as a washed up politician. You won't have Dick Nixon to kick around anymore.
Yes, you will. page 58 and on to 59. There's conversation. So the conversation between Batman and Robin about Bruce marrying Josie is cut quite a bit. And it turns into a, when you're older, we can have this conversation moment.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, did Stanley Ralph Ross write this? Because, you know, we just get that little sly reference to what the upside might have been for Bruce to marry Josie. But
right,
this
right.
kind of gets a little closer to too hot to handle.
Yes, indeed. Making bouncy bounce. Okay.
On page 60, so as we hear in the broadcast version, Robin says, if we could just solve the secret of his control mechanism, we'd have the other two robots dancing to our commands. Then the scene ends there, and we lose Batman's line, we'll do even better, old chum. Get your tools. We'll bring this nasty creature back to life. Now, I felt like without Batman's line, the Desmond Doomsday line right after that doesn't quite work as well. Because he says, for even as the Caped Crusaders toil, you know, they're toiling at bringing the nasty creature back to life, but it's left a little bit vaguer than that. In
right,
the broadcast
right.
version.
Oh, there's a typo here. I didn't notice this before. We'll bring this, on page 60, we'll bring this nasty creature back to life.
Right, it has bird nests in it.
Holy Robin's Egg Blue. Wait, well, can we talk about Dr. Floyd for a minute? Because he seems like a Stanley Ralph Ross creation. it's like right out of a Catskills sketch. Didn't really expect him. I mean, he's clearly a cross between Sigmund Freud and, I don't know, Avery Schreiber. Half the characters from Hogan's Heroes. Anyway, I was a little surprised that he made it all the way into the final draft because he's so over the top as the, you know, kooky German psychiatrist, like Dr. Hilarious from Pynchon's Crying of Lot 49. He gets somewhat distracting, I think. Even as shot, he's a little bit of a distraction. Anyway, that's just neither here nor there, I guess.
He does seem a little out of place. Maybe in season 3 he would have worked perfectly.
And like I say, in a Stanley Ralph Ross script, he would have been, like, you know, pretty much de rigueur. Like, oh, okay. I would have totally understood his presence.
Now, I think when we originally talked about this arc, I commented that on what's on page 62, where Batman picks up the bat phone and says, yes, Alfred, they shoehorned in Alfred saying, Alfred here. And I can see why, because otherwise Batman has no idea whether it's Gordon or Alfred calling.
Right, right.
And yet he's saying, yes, Alfred.
That feels like another Bible moment. Another moment where the 66 Bible, you know, the ancient law comes into play.
Mm. Well, also, Batman is not a mind reader, so...
Right, right. I mean, you know, it's just, you know, depending on where the bat phone gets picked up and who picks it up, certain rules have to be followed in order to clarify.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, he wouldn't ever do that in the study, because he knows
certainly
it's going
to
be Gordon.
Yeah.
Or it's not going to be, well, I suppose it's possible Alfred could be in the Batcave and call upstairs, but you know, I doubt if he would do that.
Yeah, I don't think so.
On 63... where Bruce is taken away in a straitjacket, it says Chief O'Hara is there with a couple of very burly cops, in all caps, and they are not very burly. They're just kind of standard cops.
Yeah. I think the all caps is there to suggest something like, you know, like undercranking in an earlier scene. It's to suggest a stage direction that speaks specifically to one of the substaffs, like, you know, cinematography crew, or, you know, or the, in this case, the props crew or the casting crew.
Mm-hmm.
But like straitjacket is also in all caps as a, you know, shout out to the props people. I don't know, Tim, but, you know, this is something that's, you know, just, you know, completely idiosyncratic to you and me. But this time around, watching Bruce being put into the straitjacket, all I could think of was David Bowie singing We Could Be Heroes. imagining him in the Bing Crosby special wearing a straitjacket. The Bing Crosby Christmas special that taught us to loathe David Bowie briefly before we both decided we really liked him a few years later.
Yeah, well, the shot of him in a straitjacket was in High Fidelity magazine.
Yes, of course, of course. I think I just imagined him wearing a straitjacket when he's singing Heroes.
In our minds, he was.
In the Bing Crosby Christmas special. Right, because he deserved to be, because we thought this was like atonal madness that we were listening to.
Yeah. Although, in our defense, if you watch him singing Heroes in the Christmas special, it's not quite as kind of melodic as the recorded version. It is a little bit weirder.
Been a long time since I heard it.
It popped up on social media a couple of years ago, I think. I'm sure it's out there somewhere on YouTube.
Oh, no doubt. Everything else is.
On 64, again, Tricky becomes trusty. Robin talks about Alfred's trusty Batman suit. When they're going to rescue Bruce from the... Lunatic Squad truck. And Semple calls for a dummy of Bruce to fall out of the truck, but they manage to avoid the need for a dummy as it's shot.
Right. He just falls out of frame, right?
Right.
Doesn't Adam West fall out of frame?
That's right.
And there's rear projection behind them, you know, making it so there's no need for a dummy. They're not actually on a road dumping anybody out of the back.
Right. So, well, you know, Bruce is no dummy.
But he might be a tricky robot.
And the final scene at the bank is pretty much the same. Just, you know, very minor, like, rewrites of lines. There's not much difference. And then, as I said, the final scene, the tag... is in the Wayne living room. And Gordon is there, but O'Hara is not. And Aunt Harriet has the final line, "Good gracious, Alfred, bring some broth. Mr. Wayne is having a relapse." Why does she call him Mr. Wayne?
To Alfred, I suppose.
I suppose, but of course that becomes O'Hara's line, "Mother of mercy, get the smelling salts. Mr. Wayne is having a relapse."
Well, I think, you know, saying Mr. Wayne to Alfred makes sense if you're talking to a servant.
Yeah, I guess so.
There is one other change, by the way. On 69, there's no mention of the stage direction of Batman lifting Josie over the railing to bring her out. And, you know, when she says, if you ever see Bruce Wayne, Batman, tell him it might have been fun.
Right. Well, and also the script doesn't have Batman saying, I'll tell him, which he does.
Right. On screen. That's right. It's a little more tender, the way that it's shot, a little more mournful. And, yet again, Batman's strange stirrings in his utility belt will get no satisfaction.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's kind of a season one moment.
With the poor deluded girl. Oh, mm-hmm.
Yeah, or, you had all those sexy saxophone scenes in the first season where, the mall is falling in love with Batman, right. Which Josie doesn't, but...
No.
The music and everything in the scene, it's kind of an echo of season one.
Yeah, it's highly compressed by comparison.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's quite a bit shorter than those season one scenes. So, that is The Joker's Last Left, first draft.
It would have been fun to, not only would it have been fun if Josie and Bruce Wayne had gotten married,
yeah.
It would also have been fun to have seen, one of the marked up scripts or even, see the final script. But we'll never know, how many more drafts it went through, I suppose.
Unless right.
another draft shows up somewhere unexpected in the next few years.
Yeah, it would be interesting. Yeah, there probably was a second draft that had some of these changes in it, and then some of the changes might have been made by Oscar Rudolph. But
so I guess final question, is anything left of Two-Face? Shakespeare is all gone. most of the duality jokes are gone after we get past the fact that the counterfeit bills are quote-unquote genuine on one side and fake on the other.
Right. Well, I mean, like I said last time, there, you can see the outline of part one of Two-Face in part one of this one. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's gone in part two. There's like right. nothing left in part two.
It does seem that way. It's been squeezed out entirely.
Mm-hmm.
Salwete. My name is Stella, and I am the host of Backroll to Oracle, the Barbara Gordon podcast. Backroll to Oracle is a podcast dedicated to Barbara Gordon, the first woman to hold the mantle of Backroll for an extended period of time, roughly 1967 to 1988. The goal of Backroll to Oracle is to examine the character's history from her first appearance as Backroll and continuing through her tenure as Oracle. Each episode looks at a vintage issue of Detective Comics or Batman, as well as other books like Justice League and Freedom Fighters, and modern issues of Batgirl and Birds of Prey. I also keep track of news involving Batgirl and other members of the Bat family, and I have a revolving series of segments like Babs in the Tube, which highlights appearances of Babs in TV and film, Shipper Spotlight, which looks at a variety of comic and pop culture couples, gives their history, and determines whether they are hot or not, Reading with Stella, which could be described as an audio drama, or just me reading a book that relates to Babs or doesn't, and of course, the mainstay literature recommendation. I have been blessed to interview writers Scott Beatty and Chuck Dixon on their Batgirl Year One work, Brian Q. Miller on his Batgirl run, Dwayne Swierczynski and Christy Marks on their separate Birds of Prey work, and the creators and actors of the Batgirl Spoiled, the web series. I hope to interview more creators and actors in the future. My goal, most importantly, is to make a fun, entertaining, and thoughtful show that people enjoy and from which they learn. Find the show online at thebatmanuniverse.net and iTunes, and follow the show on Facebook and Twitter at Batgirl to Oracle. Thank you, and fly on, Babs lovers.
Coming up, the Bat Inbox, including some of your comments about the Two-Face and Joker scripts. Help support To the Bat Polls and all the Deconstructing Comics shows with a monthly donation to the Deconstructing Comics Patreon page at patreon.com/deconcomics for as little as $2 a month. All our patrons get outtakes from every To the Bat Polls episode, the right to participate in polls to choose which of several topics you'd most like to hear us discuss on the podcast, and videos in which I quiz Paul with some TV trivia. Or send us your questions about anything and we'll answer them. For $4 a month, you can get in on additional full-length content, including an issue-by-issue look at The Amazing Spider-Man by Lee and Ditko, and discussion of most of the MCU movies. You'll also get the right to have an ad for your own project on the show once a month. So go to patreon.com/deconcomics and select the level of your monthly donation. Thanks for listening and thanks for your support. This time our Bat audio is from an interview with executive producer William Dozier for the Canadian TV program Telescope, filmed sometime during season one in 1966.
How about the guest villain concept? How did that evolve?
They are all in the comic books, and the best known ones from the comic books are the Penguin and the Joker. So the idea of the villains came from the comic books. We've invented some new ones, Mr. Freeze and King Tut, and Zelda the Great was one we invented, a female Houdini. But casting them, too, was a little bit tricky. We tried one other actor for the Penguin, and I'm glad we didn't get him, because our second choice was Burgess Meredith, and I think he's a classic in the role. We also tried one other for the Joker, and I'm glad we didn't get him, because I think Cesar Romero is just magnificent. Never thought of anybody else for the Riddler except Frank Gorshin. He was my first notion for the Riddler and never anybody else.
All of these guest villains have been what you might call straight dramatic actors. There have been no comedians among them. Why is that?
There's no room for a comedian in this show at all. If a comedian tried to do these parts, it'd go right out the window because they would be trying to be funny. They would be mugging and doing their little comedy shticks to get laughs, you know? And that's not the way you get laughs in this show. You get laughs, if they're there, by just playing it straight and overdoing the straightness.
Bat Inbox. First, some comments on the Rabe and Semple scripts from the all-seeing, all-knowing 66 Batman message board.
You know, I almost bought myself a red-armed C-3PO action figure for my birthday the other day. But I thought better of it. I mean, you know, back in the day, you could buy a Star Wars action figure. Back in, like, you know, 1978, 79, you could buy one for $2. I think they're like 12 these days. So, you know, inflation is what inflation is, but it still seems like too much to pay. So let's begin with a letter from our dear friend Ken Holzhauser. Ah, where to start? I thought Peter Rabe's Two-Face was about one solid rewrite from being an excellent season two script. The script gives no specific instructions as to the bifurcated bandit's facial appearance. Ooh, nice alliteration there, Commissioner Gordon. So the show could make him as grotesque or tame as they liked. I imagine they would have given him a swarthy, Klingon-esque, darker half with different color hair than his lighter side. Two-Face as a character was probably passed over by the producers due to his extreme appearance, and I'm sure they're still remembering the reaction to False-Face. But this dark grease paint solution fits the character as former actor and appeases potential audience reaction. The robots work better with this version of the script. Phony money, phony henchmen. His background in special effects just about makes them plausible, well, Gotham City plausible, good qualifier there, and fits his M.O. The idea of discrediting Bruce Wayne pops up briefly and is tossed away, which is unfortunate. It would have been an interesting subplot bubbling away in the background as Batman has to defend himself on two fronts. Facilia is a name begging for a rewrite. Would Dollface have been so bad? I suppose so soon after the Puzzler that the Shakespeare would have to go. Yeah, that's a really good point. Hadn't thought about the Puzzler. Mm-hmm. It's unfortunate because I did like the setup of quotations that sort of trailed off aimlessly. A year ago, when I was fan-casting contemporary actors as Batman villains, I had Robert Wagner as Two-Face. Looking at the script, I still think he could have pulled it off, but he might not be as hammy as the part required. I don't know. I remember watching Heart to Heart and thinking what a ham he was back in the 80s. I would categorize this as a disappointment. I know the rewrite was largely due to Cesar Romero's availability, but I wish there had been another inventory script to adapt into a Joker adventure. Oh, and I forgot to mention the total rewrite needed for the cliffhanger. That drill? Nope, nope, nope. Yeah, Tim and I agreed with that. Better a helmet that, quote, makes you a robot, end quote, or a headband or something less, well, grotesque. I don't think a current TV series would use that as a child-friendly cliffhanger. No, I'm sure you're right about that, Ken.
No. Let alone in the 60s. Hi C says, as you noted,
Facilia is a rough name for the henchmall, difficult to pronounce. It doesn't exactly roll off an actor's tongue. Well, if you listen to the outtakes on Patreon, I called her Felicia at one point, and then had to correct myself.
I think I might have, too. I think I might have as well.
That's the problem with having a crime novelist rather than a noir screenwriter. Rabe wasn't as used to thinking of the dialogue being read aloud.
Yeah, I think that's right.
I find it interesting that in part two, Horowitz, I assume, notes how there is a four-page set piece, pages 47 to 51 in the actual script pages, that does not advance the plot. I mean, yeah, he's spot on. But where was he with such observations during the Londinium snooze fest? And for that matter, much of season two. I won't blame him for not piping up when his boss inserted his stupid Batgirl song to get his residuals, thereby wasting much of his company's already spent time.
Nice.
Yeah, well, and I was thinking about, I mean, we were talking about how he kept questioning the implausibility of nobody noticing that those were robots. And I kept thinking, where was he to point out the implausibility that nobody would figure out Batman and Robin were persuaded Dick Grayson? There's your implausibility.
Mm-hmm.
On the Joker script, it's quite clear by then that anytime they had a script with a, quote, new, unquote, and weird villain kicking around for quite some time that they did not quite know what to do with, the consensus was rewrite it and give it to Joker. Caesar can make anything wacky and weird work, in quotes. Hence, Dr. Temporal, Astrologer, and then Two-Face. Thanks to you guys and Laramie for showing us that. Obviously, Semple was trying to do some kind of bad Miranda Rights joke with the officer using excessive force in the teaser scene, but it's way too violent. I just don't get what he was thinking. What do you think of that theory?
Well, I'm trying to remember when, I guess Miranda warning is derived from the 66 U.S. Supreme Court case, and I'm reading right out of Wikipedia here. I think there's some plausibility to that. I think that is possible. Semple seems, again, to be kind of keyed into issues of the justice system, of, you know, the how culpability gets measured, and whether, you know, the Batman and Robin are going to need to pull off some kind of ab scam deal in order to maneuver a Joker into making himself guilty enough to actually, you know, throw the book at him and make the charges stick. So yeah, I think that's plausible.
So what was the episode that did reference Miranda vaguely? I think it might have been the Liberace one?
Yeah, might have been. All I can think of is Adam West's Miranda song right now. I can't get it out of my head. Now the whole world has gone for dead, and I can't get it out of my head. Now. Not sure I could come up with a reference to the actual episode at this point.
Yeah, I remember it's Gordon and O'Hara in the interrogation room.
Right.
But yeah, I'm pretty sure, yeah, that it's Chandel.
Okay.
My name is Alfred Sly, sir. I'm a noted criminal attorney. Very incautious of you to begin this interrogation without my presence, wasn't it? Chief. A most unwelcome arrival just when the fellow was beginning to talk.
You want me to toss the mouthpiece out?
Oh, heaven forfend, Chief O'Hara, in today's climate that could land us behind bars.
Josie is written as a bit more street smart than Phyllis Douglas was capable of playing. She never really advanced beyond ingenue. She might have been out of their price range, but I would love to have seen Pamela Austin in this role. I'm not sure who that is.
Keep going.
Okay, Paul will be Googling. She, come to think of it, also could have been a good protege for Catwoman in Catwoman Goes to College. I still never understood why Stanley Ralph Ross made the setting a sorority house with no sorority sisters in it. Probably so he could use that Theta Beta Latke potato pancake, darling, or whatever it was.
No doubt.
even though it made it into the finished arc, I don't like the robot saying, "Your wallet, sir, or you get a bullet between the eyes." Yeah, I agree with that. A bit intense for a so-called kids show, but I did like the Batcave improvement loan line. The other problem with that is, I mean, remember who programmed the robots to do that? Not Joker. Batman.
Yes, that's right.
So, you know, if the robot did shoot somebody, you know, Batman's culpable.
Mm-hmm. Yes, indeed, indeed. Right, so did he program that line into them to make, once again, you know, maybe this is about, what's the word you used before? Not coercion, but...
Entrapment?
Entrapment, yes, yes, indeed. About Pamela Austin, she was in Elvis movies. She was in two Elvis movies. And gained fame, according to Wikipedia, for a series of popular automobile television commercials for Dodge, Charger, Coronet, and Polara, and other models. As the perky Dodge Rebellion girl, she appeared in around 20 commercials as a damsel in distress, menaced by sharks, falling from a drawbridge, a roof, a cargo plane, etc. Her tagline at the end of each ad was, "The Dodge Rebellion wants you." Wow. How did that ad campaign escape us for so long? Anyway, interesting thought. She was also on, I believe, 77 Sunset Strip.
Of course. there should have been like a shoot directing her right to Batman in that case.
Yes, exactly, exactly.
She must have known Howie Horowitz. And Heisty goes on, "This may be heresy to you, but this just doesn't seem as tightly written as a first season Semple script." I kind of agree with that.
I do too. I mean, it's unusual. It doesn't feel like a script that he knew that he had some control over, since he didn't actually. He is rewriting it and changing villains as well as trying to mold it into a more Batman-like piece of work.
For instance, the robots vacillate between stiff and smooth, robotic and natural, conforming to whatever the plot needs at the moment. Yeah, when Mr. Glee in the bank, when my wife Josephine, he doesn't sound like a robot there at all.
No, that's true.
The more invested Semple was better than that. It reminds me of the difference in Gene Kuhn in the Trek scripts when he was producer and when he had left and was writing under a pseudonym for legal reasons. This, of course, is not Spock's brain level bad.
Yeah, sorry, that's bad.
But it is equally ludicrous even by Batman standards. Robots aren't reprogrammed because Joker just says so. And it lacks the care and feeding of an early Semple script. It feels like he wrote it double parked with the meter running.
Yes, an apt metaphor.
So, then on to a couple of messages about our episode on the Return to the Batcave special.
Here's Batwing Hornet. "I watched this when it originally aired, and I have to admit, the commercials were a bit exciting because it was part of a time when production companies were mining an interest in TV series of the 60s and 70s. For example, 1997, Hey Hey, It's the Monkees, which was a sequel of sorts to the TV series, ABC. 1999, Come On, Get Happy, : The Partridge Family Story, ABC. 2000, Growing Up Brady, the biographical film co-produced by Barry Greg Brady Williams, NBC. 2001, CBS aired Surviving Gilligan's Island, the incredibly true story of the longest three-hour tour in history, which, like Return to the Batcave, was also co-produced by Don Wells and Larry Germain. It's interesting that, after the 80s, which brought us a lot of Gilligan's Island movies and other continuations of series, by the late 90s and early 2000s, at least if this list is to be understood as representative, we're moving into a more meta relationship between these kinds of shows and the original series, where they're more about the history of them rather than continuations of the stories themselves.
Right. Well, then around the same time, or maybe a little bit earlier, you're also getting movies kind of based off of those shows, like the Shelley Long Brady Bunch movie, which I've never seen. But I know that it's more of a, I guess it's kind of a parody of Brady Bunch or a commentary on it.
Definitely, yeah. It's more like the Will Ferrell. No, that's not right. It's more like the Luke Wilson Starsky and Hutch movie with Ben Stiller. It's more like the recent Chips movie. They didn't do all that well in the box office, but they are basically like winking campy parodies of the original shows rather than continuations.
Or the Dan Aykroyd Dragnet.
Yes, that's a version of that too. But yeah, the Gary Cole, Shelley Long, Brady Bunch movie is basically just a long running joke about how out of step the Bradys are with the 2000s or with the late 90s, mid 90s, I guess, even. They're just like, you know, they're, you know, eating, you know, Wonder Bread with mayonnaise smeared on it, while everyone else is like, you know, changed and grown and transformed and, you know, much more kind of diversified ways. Mm-hmm.
But, you know, in that period, you had Addams Family movies, you had Flintstones movies, you know, live action, no less. Mm-hmm. And wasn't there, I don't remember seeing much of it, but wasn't there a Beverly Hillbillies movie?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think, what's his name? Ernest. The guy who played Ernest played the Buddy Ebsen role in the Beverly Hillbillies movie. And Cloris Leachman may have been Granny. Anyway, I'm murdering names and references there, but not the point of our show. When we start doing a Beverly Hillbillies movie franchise podcast, we'll let everybody know. Let's see. So just to finish off Batwing Hornet's email, or his post, like everyone else, Return to the Batcave's disappointment stemmed from the TV special only being able to use the 1966 movie for clips and the casting. Poor Jason Marsden. He was not built like Bert at all, but more like the Mego Bendenflex figure, which Batwing Hornet has kindly provided an image of, hilariously. Bert started off thin, but over the first season and into the movie, he gained weight and had been working out and really looked the part. Marsden would work if he was on the same peg as that Bendy. Nice. No TV movie is going to be a comprehensive look at a TV series, but I recall thinking most TV biographical entries took liberties with known history, merged experiences, or repackaged debunked myths. But the fact the shows were getting this kind of attention at all was fun. That said, I was disappointed that there was no mention of the Green Hornet as a production at all. Referring to it as part of Dozier's brief universe would have been a no-brainer, and they did not need clips from the series for that. Part of Batman's legacy was its connection to the Green Hornet, but its absence from the TV movie made its world seem smaller. Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah. Finally, Dan E. Cool. I can understand your critiques about this TV special. Return definitely takes some creative license with reality, but I still love it. It's not a documentary by any means. It feels more like a chat with your grandparent as they reminisce over their wartime achievements.
It's best and embellish just, them a little bit.
It's best just to nod and accept the obvious exaggerations. Of course, Gramps took an entire platoon single-handed with nothing but his buck knife and a shoestring. Interrupting with factual corrections is rude and unseemly.
And unnecessary.
Seeing Adam and Bert back together is worth the price of admission. And maybe I'm in the minority here, but I find the reenactments enjoyable too. It's just a shame they hadn't made it a decade earlier, so some of the other stars could have played a part too.
I did really, really like watching the reenactment of the Bat Climb in Back to the Batcave. That was fun.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was enjoyable. You know, it was an hour and 40 minutes of my life that I'll never get back, but I don't mind losing it to that. So take that as the compliment, the complimentary tone in which it's intended.
So we have started giving the patrons at patreon.com/deconcomics a poll on which podcast topic to do next. We've done one already. We'll do them periodically. I don't know, maybe once every month or two. We haven't quite decided. One of the choices we gave them on this first poll was an idea that was suggested by someone who took our listener survey, quoting, possibly do episodes where you rank your favorite episodes, gadgets, villain/actor, bat trap, etc. We're trying to think of more than four categories. If you have any suggestions, you probably got a few days after this comes out, maybe up to a week, that you could email us at batpoles@deconstructingcomics.com to send other suggestions before we record our episode. So if you're listening to this as soon as it comes out, you know, email us very soon.
And in general, don't be shy. Email us, post to the Bat message board, whatever, however you can get in touch with us. If you've never done it before, please don't feel hesitant. We're always interested in hearing from you.
Hmm. And we're still curious about if there are more than two women who listen to our show. We'd like to know about more of those listeners.
Yes.
Okay. That's it for this time. Thanks for listening. We'll be back in 2 weeks at the same Bat RSS feed. Check the show notes for the video of William Cheung's version of the Batman theme and a link to the draft script of The Joker's Last Laugh. We're always looking for more Bat audio clips to play in the slot before the Bat inbox. If you have some we haven't used, send them to batpoles@deconstructingcomics.com. You can hear outtakes from this and every episode of To the Batpoles and vote for future podcast topics by supporting us at patreon.com/deconcomics. You can also help us out by shopping via deconstructingcomics.com/amazon, by sharing our episodes on your social media, and by subscribing to the show on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen. And spread the word. Let all your friends who are Batman 66 fans know about the show. Send us your comments at batpoles@deconstructingcomics.com or tweet us at @deconcomics. You can also leave a comment on this post at tothebatpoles.libsyn.com. What you're hearing now is Neil Hefti with Gotham City Municipal Swing Band. Next time, our favorite villains, bat gadgets, malls, and more. Everyone stay safe, and we'll see you in 2 weeks. To the Batpoles is a production of DeconstructingComics.com.